गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक इन इकोनॉमिक्स, दैट इज सेंट्रल बैंक डिजिटल करेंसी। बिफोर दैट लेट मी इंट्रोड्यूस माई सेल्फ। आई एम मधुसूदन, ए ग्रेजुएट ऑफ IIT खड़गपुर एंड आई एम एन एक्स ऑफिसर ऑफ नबार्ड। सो वी शैल अंडरस्टैंड व्हाई वी आर स्टडिंग दिस टॉपिक, व्हाट आर द सिमिलरिटी विद अदर फॉर्म ऑफ करेंसी, how is it different from the physical currency that we currently hold, and how is it different from the bitcoin or upi that we have currently. So let's understand them one by one. So first of all, let's understand why we are studying this, because it was in news, or just you can see that India has launched a pilot project for this. So pilot project means we are experimenting currently with a central bank digital currency, and once this experiment is successful, we can have a full fledged digital currency in India. And even today our governor, RBI governor, is saying that this is going to be a major transformation in the way business is being done. We shall understand how it is going to be a major transformation. So let's first understand what is a central bank digital currency. So as is in the name, it is a kind of currency. We currently have this kind of currency, but this is a digital currency. Digital currency means what will change? Because physical currency, you have a physical wallet. In case of digital currency, you will have a digital wallet in your mobile phone. So in your mobile phone, in this wallet, you will have it digitally. So you cannot feel it. In physical currency, you can touch your 100 rupees note, 1000 rupees note. No, 1000 rupees note is no more in circulation. So whatever currency notes are there, you can feel it. But digital currency, you can only see in your digital wallet in your mobile phone. The next thing is that it is a central bank digital currency. What it means, that this is a digital currency which is being issued by central bank. In our case, it is RBI which is issuing this digital currency. So here is a definition. CBDC is a digital form of currency notes issued by a central bank. Okay, so in this definition itself, it explains the different nuances, different features of central bank digital currency. This same CBDC is also being known as e-rupee. In short, we are writing it as e-ray. Okay, this is also being called as digital rupee. Okay, you can understand why it is being called as digital rupee, because it is rupee which is in the digital form. Okay, let's move further. So first thing that we have seen, it is a currency. So how is it similar to currency? Because it is a legal tender. Legal tender means it is acceptable as a medium of exchange in India. Okay, so like the cash is acceptable, so would be the digital currency. Then it is backed by RBI, we have discussed it. Then it is issued in denomination. So like physical currency, we have in denomination of 10 rupees, 20 rupees, 100 rupees, 50 rupees, 500, 2000. Similarly, even this digital rupee would be issued in these similar denomination. Whatever denomination we have physical cash, the same denomination we will have for digital rupee. And then it will also not earn any interest. If you have cash 100 rupees, it would remain 100 rupees even 1 year after that. So would be the value of digital rupee. Unlike a money kept in your saving account which grows with time, this digital rupee will not grow with time. It would remain same. Okay, so this is the similarity with the physical currency. But it is a bit different with the physical currency as well. How is it different? First thing is its form. It is digital form. And then because it is in digital form, contactless transaction is possible. In physical form, there has to be a physical transaction. At the same time, it can be used for offline as well as online. So if you are doing some shopping in an offline mode, then you can pay with digital rupee. But if you are doing shopping in online mode, you cannot pay with cash, but you can pay with digital currency. This is the advantage that it is going to bring. Then it can be programmed. Now this is something that you should understand very carefully. When we say that digital currency can be programmed, it means that it can be tuned, that it can be used only for a particular purpose. For example, if you have currently 500 rupee, you can use it for any purposes. But if this 500 rupee has been given to you by the government for buying books, the government can program the digital rupee that this 500 digital rupee can only be used for buying books. This is called programming of digital currency. Now, this is going to increase the effectiveness of government schemes manifold. We are increasingly going for direct benefit transfer and indirect benefit transfer. If we transfer programmed money, then it would increase the effectiveness and reduce the leakages from the government schemes. So this is going to be a very game-changing innovation for this digital rupee. Although government is currently not talking much about it, but this is one of the future prospects. Then the physical currency is made up of currency papers, whereas this digital currency is made up of blockchain technology. This you must remember, prelims mein ye question aa sakta hai. Digital currency is made up on which technology? It is blockchain technology. But you might be aware that we already have certain currencies which are made on this blockchain technology, which are known as cryptocurrency. So the next question comes, how is digital rupee or e-rupee different from the cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin, which are already in circulation? Well, you might have already guessed it. The first and major difference is that this is backed by RBI. So it is a legal tender. Whereas these Bitcoins are not backed by RBI, so they are not a legal tender. And since it is being backed by RBI and it is also being issued by RBI, it is centralized. In case of Bitcoin or cryptocurrencies, these are decentralized. This is their best thing, that there is no central authority which is controlling them, but these CBDC would be controlled by RBI. Then because they are not controlled by RBI, they have high level of anonymity. In case of Bitcoin, it is afraid that one can use it for the terror operation, can fund the criminal activities, because you cannot monitor it, where it is going, where it is coming from. The same is not possible because in case of CBDC, since it is being issued by RBI, RBI can monitor its movement. So the risk that it would be used for the terror funding is less in case of e-rupee or digital rupee. Another major difference is that this RBI has said that the e-rupee would be pegged to the physical rupee that we have, and it can be exchanged one-on-one. It means 100 digital rupee would have same value as 100 rupee, and you can always go to the bank and change it with the physical cash. Okay, the same is not with case of Bitcoins or cryptocurrency. In fact, they are very much volatile. You often see in the news that the Bitcoin has increased the prices by 33% or 40% in one day. Such kind of volatility is there, and that makes them a kind of asset. Because many people are investing in Bitcoin. You might have seen the ad as well. Have you invested in Bitcoin? Okay, so it's not a currency per se. It is more of a kind of asset which is being used for increased income. And since you are getting income from this asset, this income is being taxed as well. The government of India last year introduced a taxation on any income gain out of crypto assets. No such taxation or income is there in case of digital rupee, as we have seen that here the value remains 100-200 only. Okay, so these are the differences. I hope you have understood it clearly. These nuances you must understand. One statement can be made out of this, or even in mains one simple question can be this, that how is it different from the existing cryptocurrencies. So these are the point that you should write. Then the next doubt comes, that overall we have seen that the cryptocurrencies were a kind of asset, whereas this is more or less a currency which is a mode of payment. But we already have some mode of payment, and one of the very popular mode of payment, that is UPI. And in case of UPI also, we have it in mobile phone. This is also a kind of something which you cannot feel. So many people are saying that how is it different? Both are the same thing. Then see, there is some difference. And one of the basic difference between them is that it is a currency. As we have said, it is a legal tender. UPI is not a currency. UPI is just a technology. It is a technology to transfer your money from someone else. Okay, not a money per se. Okay, and the next thing is that when you transfer money through UPI, there are various intermediaries which are involved. In case of digital rupee, the transfer would be direct. Jab aap UPI se transfer karte hain, for example, it's first your bank which is involved, bank X. This, and before that, there is some UPI app like Google Pay. Then UPI app connects with bank. This bank talk with another bank. This bank then talk with another UPI app which your friend has, and then your friend gets a message. So many communication happens when you do one UPI transaction. And obviously, if there are so many intermediaries involved, no one is doing this for the free. They will charge something. Today UPI is free, but tomorrow it is expected that in the way there is charge on credit card payment, debit card payment, similarly, there would be some charge on UPI in future. Otherwise, it would become an unviable proposition. Okay, same would not be the case of digital currency. Because digital currency would be like currency. If you give 100 rupee to your friend, it's you and your friend which are involved. Similarly, simply in case of e-rupee, it's your wallet and your phone friend wallet. Okay, and the currency would simply go from A to B. There would be no intermediary. Since there is no intermediary, there shall not be any transfer payment. There shall not be any charges. So there shall not be transfer cost. And if there is intermediary, definitely someone is watching you. Someone is saying that you are transferring, even if you transfer 1 rupee. In case of digital currency, it is expected that RBI would provide some degree of anonymity. Like low value transaction would not be monitored by RBI. So it would be some anonymity, the way we have anonymity with respect to cash. Okay. The same is not available for UPI. But then in case of digital currency, there would be loss of interest. Because this is like a cash, as we have discussed earlier. If you have it in your wallet, you will not earn anything. But in case of UPI, you have money in your saving account. And in saving account, you earn interest payment. So this is a loss that you will have if you use digital wallet. But then here it comes a question. If banks are not involved, if banks are not paying any interest in case of digital rupee, the news that we have seen, it says that 4 banks, State Bank of India, ICICI Bank, Yes Bank and IDFC First Bank, these are the 4 banks which are involved in this pilot project. So if banks are not involved, what are they doing? So their role is the distribution of this money. For example, in case of cash, it is you and your friend which is involved in the payment. But how would you get that cash? Through bank branch, through ATM. So similarly, they are doing this distribution function of an ATM. They will set up the digital wallet. Every bank would have their own digital wallet. And this, whichever bank you have bank account, you will download their wallet, you will download your money the way you take money out of ATM. So banks are doing this function that they do as an ATM in the physical cash that they are doing in case of digital cash. Okay. The next thing comes is, why are we going to do all this thing? What is the need? So there are various actors which are going to benefit in this case of digital currency. Let's consider one by one. Consumer, they are having the biggest benefit. They do not have to carry cash. The same way you are carrying cash, you will take money rather than going to ATM, you will download money from your bank in case of digital money. So this is the benefit that consumer will have. In case of merchant, they would also not have to carry the cash. because cash has a cost, it can be even looted, there is a risk, security risk as well. At the same time, if they accept payment in credit card, they have to pay the merchant discount rate. In case of digital cash, there shall not be any merchant discount rate. It would be as free as cash. Like many shopkeeper would not accept credit card, or they will say, pay me 2% extra, then only I would accept payment from the credit card. That problem will go away because they will accept in the digital format for free. Then for banks, the risk of bank run would reduce. You might be knowing that bank run is a scenario when a lot many customers are asking their deposit from the bank at the same time. So if bank fails to provide cash to them, then this scenario is known as bank run. Now that people do not need cash, I mean ultimately when digital rupee would be popular, India would move towards a cashless society. Okay, so in case of cashless society, people would not demand cash from the bank. So that risk of going for a bank run would reduce. So bank would not need to keep cash with them. In that case, they can lend more of their money, the deposit, to the people. So there shall be more expansion of the banking system because they would have more money to lend to the people. But then the government has the benefit, it can program it. So the efficiency of the government schemes will increase. It can trace it, like the terror funding problem will be solved, which is the problem with the cryptocurrencies. So these are the benefits that the government has. And then RBI is the biggest beneficiary. How? Because the cash management cost of RBI, which was last year to the tune of around 5,000 crore. So every year around 4,000 to 5,000 crore rupees are spent by RBI to distribute this cash, print this cash, etc. That cost would be reduced manifold in case digital rupee becomes the popular medium. And then obviously the payment and settlement system would become efficient because there would be less number of intermediaries. There would be innovation in cross-border payment because today what you have to do, you have to transfer your rupee into dollar if you want to make any international payment. That need not to be done because digital currency may be accepted across the border. Okay, so this is also a possibilities that can happen in the future. Then the problem of money laundering, terror financing, tax evasion, which are there with the private cryptocurrencies, that are also going to be solved with CBDC. So because of all these benefits that various stakeholders are going to have, the RBI is pushing for the central bank digital currency. And India is one of the very few countries, like South Africa, China are the other major economy which are in the pilot phase, and India is one of the very few countries which are experimenting with central bank digital currencies. But all is not well. There are some people who are a bit apprehensive about the digital currency as well. They also see some risk in this. Okay. So let's see what are the risks associated with them. The first is privacy issue. As we have seen, it is up to RBI how much monitoring they want to do with respect to digital rupee. They can monitor every transaction or they can leave the small value transaction. So this concern is always there. And then there could be difficulty in use. For example, UPI has become very popular because it is easy to use. You have to simply scan the QR code system. Okay, if CBDC is going to be as easy or not is yet to be known. Probably this is the purpose of pilot program, that they want to make it easy to use. And then there can be technical glitch, as is the case with like Aadhaar payment we have seen. Same is UPI as well. In case there is no internet, you cannot make the payment. So this challenge is going to remain with the digital currency as well. Like it is also being tried that we can make digital payment or payment with the digital rupee even without internet. It is still not clear if it is possible with respect to digital rupee or not, but it is the efforts are being made that it can happen mobile to mobile even without internet. If this happens, then this technical problem is very much solved. Then there is problem of hacking and virus attack, as is the case with all information technology related assets. There is also a problem of mindset of people. that like earlier many people were not accepting digital payment. Why? Because they only believe only if they can touch the cash, it is cash. They always believe it, if it is in my account, I may not access it when I need it. Okay, so this apprehension of people would have to be addressed as well. But definitely, as we have done after the demonetization, we have addressed it very much, and hopefully we are going to address in the future as well. Obviously, government would have to run the awareness program as well in the case of digital rupee as well. So that's it that we have on this topic. If you have any doubt, please mention it in the comment section. Thank you.